Hello? Is it working?
Hello.
Welcome to the March 27th meeting of the Columbia Rotary Club, one of the world's largest Rotary clubs. And I'm always proud. I just came from the district conference this weekend, and I'm always proud of my association with this club when I go anywhere else. It's always a special thing, and it makes me feel good to be part of this group. We will start off today with Rusty and Audrey with the national anthem.
Sensible to the wonder of your creation and care, to the worth and needs of every being, to the quiet sure presence of your Holy Spirit to strengthen and guide me in your way. For as my days are yours, so shall I find my strength. Dear Lord, we thank you for this meal and ask your blessings on those who prepare it. Bless this food to the nourishment of our bodies and us to thy service. Amen.
Thank you, MZ. Bereva Harris will come up and introduce our visiting Rotarians and guests.
Historic week.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Here you go.
I'm Beth Dindorf. I'd like to introduce my guest, Mr. Francis Shadowski, Vice President for Advancement at Columbia College.
I'd like to introduce my guest today, Kevin Steelman. He made it part of Tall Guys Day today. We've got a few tall people here. Kevin is CEO of Landtech, which is a fabulous real estate development company here in town. They do a lot of great projects, and if you want to know more about what he does, catch him after the meeting. Thank you. All right, I'm going to ask you to take a minute or two and move around the room and meet and greet some of your fellow Rotarians and some of our guests today. Bob Crutchfield's going to do health and happiness, and here he comes.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
It's not a tall day for everybody. I'll tell you something somebody just told me. Do you realize that the University of South Carolina has won more games in Madison Square Garden than the Knicks have this month?
Yeah.
Okay, I actually got a couple jobs today. One of them, I was asked last week if I would say something about the golf tournament, and then Jimmy Derrick called me yesterday and told me he was going out of town and he was supposed to help and happiness. So we'll put some of this together. But first of all, I'll talk about the golf tournament for just a few minutes. It's on Monday, April the 17th. That's the day after Easter. It's at 11:30 in the morning. It's a shotgun start. We've been having these golf tournaments for many, many years. And I can't actually tell you when it started, but I can tell you that it's been an awful lot to not only this club, but the community in which we live, because of the money we've been able to funnel back into a lot of nonprofits. But it costs $80 to go. But I think the main thing you need to know is you don't have to be a golfer. Listen, I won't name their names, but there's 10 people in here tell you I'm not a golfer and I play. And they have like an ABCD player, so if you're a D player, you can make the practice fellowship. It's fun. The places that you really build relationships in this club is when you get out and you do something together. One-on-one, you'll never gain more than you will by Rainbow Salvation Armyville. Group type things, you'll see it when you're out here playing golf or when you go out and do some events in the community or something else, and it means a lot for us to be visible and be out there. I asked, as a matter of fact, let me say this too. Bill McDaniels helped us many, many years as a sponsor on golf tournaments. In the last few years, JT's helped us off a lot. But between both of them, they haven't done what this man's done. He owns one of them. He's the one that's cut the deal, that's allowed us to play golf, and allowed us to make money and put back in the community. And I think he'll give him a nice round of applause. Okay, Okay, so it's 80 bucks, or if you bring four, it's 300. Save you $20 by doing that. There's a putt-putt contest where you can win $100. There's a, you got a bag lunch, you got a meal to eat in the evening when we get through. And I asked John this morning about tennis courts, because we've got a lot of tennis players in this club. And I don't know, and I do play tennis, not well, but I do play it. But anybody that has an interest in playing tennis, let me know. Call me, email me, fax me, something, let me know, and hopefully we can maybe get something going there. And we might be doubles or mixed doubles or singles or whatever else, as long as I don't have to play Michael Conn. Okay, Alexander Seabury, where are you? Stand up. She's with the Columbia Ballet, and she's got something to share with you.
Right. Hello, everyone. I'm Alexander Seabury with Columbia City Ballet. Wanted to just let you know that we are in the process of producing a world premiere, Emmanuel Levesey Dancer. This will be a tribute to the Emmanuel 9 tragedy in Charleston that happened, and we'll be produce a message of healing, harmony, and peace. And the world premiere is this Saturday in Charleston at the Centilli Theater, and then we will do another performance in Camden in honor of Fred Shaheen, who has passed. And then we'll bring it to Columbia on April 7th and 8th at the Cooper Center. Thank you.
Very good, thank you. You know, and I'm told that Gil McMaster had a fun, wonderful governor's ball on Friday night. And the reason I know that is because Reba Harris told me that. She's the one that introduced the visitors to a guest a while ago. And I got talking with her a little bit, and she coaches her real job. Her real job, Benedict, is charged with institutional education, but she also coaches 12-year-olds on a volleyball team, and this is a team that's kind of like AAU volleyball. They've got 36 teams, and over the years, they finished second, third, fourth. Not this year. This year, they won it. So let's give her a hand. Okay. I did hear one thing. Gladys Blackman, who many of you know, passed away here probably a week or 10 days ago, and the funeral was what, this weekend, was it? And her husband Charles was a member of this club for many, many years and sat at this table right here. Okay, that was about the golf tournament, and now talk for just a minute about health and happiness. And I told somebody a while ago, I have three folders in my desk for health and happiness, and if you do it long over years, you would have to accumulate something like this. One of them says appropriate. One of them says non-appropriate, and one of them I'm not real sure about.
It says rusty.
Well, I may give you one of the questionable ones, but we'll see if John doesn't kick me off the stage. All right, let me tell you something I heard this morning I thought was cute. This guy said, did you ever wake up and kiss the person next to you that was sleeping? I mean, doesn't that give you just a great feeling? And he said, but I don't think they're going to be flying on that airline anymore. Frank and Diane were at a shopping center around Christmas time, and they had a lot to do. And Diane looked around, she couldn't find Frank, and apparently he wandered off, so she called him on his cell phone and said, where are you, man? We got a lot to do. He said, well, you remember about 10 years ago, we were out here in the mall, and we went to this jewelry store, and they had this diamond necklace that she absolutely fell in love with, and I knew that I couldn't afford to pay for it, but I told you one day I'd get it. She said, I know right where that is. He said, I'm next door at Hooters. I thought it was funny that. Okay. Last one. Remember, I only had so many hours to do this. A farmer stopped by a local mechanic shop, had his car worked on, and apparently they couldn't get it ready while he waited. So I don't live far from here. I'll just walk home. So he took off, started walking home, and as he did, he went into a hardware store and bought a bucket, and he bought a gallon of paint. And then he went on down the road and he stopped at a feed store and he bought two chickens and a goose. And he got outside and he realized it was very difficult to carry this. And about that time, this little old lady came by and said, do you know where 1703 Magnolia Street is? He said, you know what? As a matter of fact, I do. As a matter of fact, it's right down from where my house is. And she said, and he said, besides that, he said, I can't carry all this stuff. And she said, well, just do put the bucket here and the paint there and he's over here and whatever. Anyway, and she helped him by carrying something. And so anyway, they got on down the road and walked going toward his house, and then she said, or he said, you know what, I know a shortcut right here that we can take, we'll get there a lot faster. And she said, now, I'm not married, and I don't have any husband to defend me, and I go, how do I know that if I go down this alley with you, that you won't do things you probably shouldn't do? He said, lady, I got a bucket in this hand with paint in it. I got a bucket in this hand, I got a gallon of paint in this hand. I got a bird under each arm, and I'm carrying the goose. How in the world could I possibly do that? She said, well, if you set the pen with the geese over there, put the bucket on some table, it'll be a fine show. Thank you.
Bob said he was going to talk about the basketball game this weekend, but I think he forgot. And I want to tell you what, when it comes to health and happiness, has anything in this town caused more happiness than that basketball game Sunday night? I'm telling you what, this town is just busting with happiness. I haven't seen anything like it. That little cheerleading session they did in front of the Colonial Center when the team came back last night was really, really fun to watch. And it's just, it's fun to see this town get that excited about what's going on with sports. So I'm really taken by it, and I'm having a great time watching it kind of from the sidelines. What I'd like to do now, take a few minutes and report back to you on the district conference. Ann Walker and I represented our club at the district conference this weekend, Friday, Saturday, in Hilton Head. And it was a very informative couple of days. And what I want to do is let you know a little bit about what's going on in the Rotary world that I learned about while I was there. And one of the most interesting parts of going to the district conference for me is finding out what other Rotary clubs are doing, both in this country and around the world. And Ann Matthews was there. I think most of you know Ann Matthews. Ann is a member of the Columbia East Club, is the first lady vice president of Rotary International, and somebody who is truly a committed, right down to the bone Rotarian. She is really special. And by the way, she's quite a Gamecocks fan. She was leading the cheers as the Friday night game was being played. She was right in the front cheering for her Gamecocks. But anyway, she told me she is an advocate for clean water programs around the world. And she told me about Walter Hughes. You may remember Walter. He came here to speak a little over a year ago. Walter's from a small Rotary club in Western Virginia. And Walter started a program through his club, started to do one clean water well in Ghana. And the first one led to another one, that led to another one. And I think when he was here speaking, he'd done 40 or 50 wells. And he now has drilled over 500 wells in Ghana and South Sudan. 500 wells. One Rotarian had an idea. He got funding. He got matching grants. He got money from Rotary International and other matches. He's put a lot of his own money in it. Apparently, he was an early investor in AOL and made some money in that process. He's put a lot of his own money in it. He is. Bought a well drilling truck for a guy in Ghana. And the really unique benefit of this whole thing is that by what they've done, by giving the residents, the folks who live in Ghana and South Sudan, clean drinking water, they have almost 100% eliminated the guinea worm disease in those two countries. President Carter and his Carter Foundation, as you know, have said that's one of the most horrible diseases anywhere in the world. And this one Rotarian has led the way to not only provide 500 different communities with clean drinking water, but in that process, he has eliminated one of the great scourges in this world. And pretty amazing what one of your fellow Rotarians has done in this world. Buford Rotary Club has funded a very effective anti-bullying program to use in schools. As you know, bullying has become a real epidemic with the internet and with all the social media opportunities. People used to be just bullied in school, but now they leave school and through the social media they continue to be bullied all day long and into the night. And obviously suicide rates are skyrocketing with young people who can't get away from that. The Buford Rotary Club has founded a program to teach schools to teach anti-bullying programs. And this program in Buford goes around our state and goes to various high schools around the state to teach them how to put programs together to stop bullying. The Lake Murray Irmo Club started a Rotaract Club in the Turbyville Prison. And these are all young prisoners in Turbyville, because to be a Rotaract person, you have to be under 30. And so these are younger prisoners. They are, most of the prisoners are people who are in a shock program, and that's not electric kind of shock, but it's a program to try to get young offenders in and out, get them retrained and get them back out into the world to be productive citizens. But they started this Rotaract Club trying to sell the benefits of being a Rotarian, all the ideals that we believe in. They started with 5 members in the club, and they now have 55 members in the club. The lady who started the program worked for the Department of Corrections. She at one time was at the juvenile prison here in Columbia on Broad River Road, but she's now involved with the prison in Turbyville. She brought 2 young men with her who spoke to the district conference, both of whom were prisoners. They were dressed nicely, they were dressed in suits, and one of them was a college student before he went to prison. And he said he made some really stupid mistake while he's in college, and as a result of that, he's incarcerated. He is the president of the Rotaract Club in the prison, and they call themselves the Gang for Good. And it's a really unique thing, and apparently it's having a very, very positive effect, particularly on the younger prisoners in the Turbyville prison. And so hopefully many of those guys will get out, go back to productive lives. And these 2 fellows who were there, that were members of that club, spoke and talked about how grateful they are to Rotary for what Rotary has done for them and helping them understand the kind of values that we aspire to as Rotarians. And they said it's really been a great life-changing experience for them. The Hilton Head Rotary Club, I guess, discovered with the help of a lady who was trying to run an adult daycare for people with Alzheimer's disease in Hilton Head, that there was no facility for that. She was creating a daycare and moving from church to church or wherever she could find a space to allow caregivers to bring the people they're caring for, the Alzheimer's patients, into the daycare just to get a little relief for a day, to get away and have some time away from all of their caregiving. And it was really a problem because they never knew where they were going to be the next day. And so the Hilton Head Rotary Club decided that we need a permanent place for this. They raised $250,000 and were very involved in building the facility, and now Hilton Head has a permanent daycare facility for people with Alzheimer's disease. So I think we can all be proud of what our fellow Rotarians do around the state. Some pretty remarkable projects pretty special. And one of the other things too, they had the exchange students, all the exchange students who are working, who are being sponsored by Rotary Clubs there, and there were 35 students, either students who had come into this country from another country, or students who were getting ready to go out, U.S. students who were getting ready to go out on their exchange program. And they were the most excited, energetic, enthusiastic group of people. And we We noticed that they were the last ones on the dance floor Friday night when everybody else was in there watching the basketball game. They were still in there dancing, having a great time. But a really wonderful group of young people and are just so excited about being in the United States. We are going to sponsor a exchange student next year. Good deal in that. They already have residential arrangements made, but we are going to be the sponsoring club, so hopefully this exchange student coming in the fall will be participating with us on certain events and be at meetings here. But it was really exciting to watch that interaction with those young people. Most of the clubs who sponsored the exchange students were along the coast, from Hilton Head, Beaufort, Charleston, Georgetown, Myrtle Beach. Really very few exchange students from the center part of the state, so hopefully that's a program our club participated in previously. I know Joe was involved in arranging that years ago, and maybe it's something we can start doing again. One of the things, a couple of comments that were made that talked to me about what it is to be a Rotarian, that I heard quotes that I noted and wrote down. One is this: we are defined as what we do with what we have. And I think that says a lot about Rotarians, because Rotarians are very giving people. And another comment that was made, someone said, I was in Rotary many years before Rotary was in me. And I think that certainly speaks to me, because I was a Rotarian probably for 15 or 20 years before Rotary grabbed my heart and said, there are a lot of good things we can do as part of this fantastic large organization. And it is true. I think all of us need to be thinking about whether Rotary has our heart or not, or whether it just has our minds at this time. Anyway, so that's kind of an update on what was going on at the district conference, and it's worth the trip. Long drive to Hilton Head, but it certainly was worth the trip. So at this point in time, I would like to introduce Beth Dendorf, who will introduce our speaker for the day.
President John, it is my great honor today to introduce Mr. Tommy Preston Jr., the Director of National Strategy and Engagement at Boeing, where he focuses on regulatory, public policy, grassroots strategy, and community engagement. Most recently, he practiced law at Nexon Pruitt here in South Carolina, where he represented many companies, including Boeing. A native of South Carolina, Tommy graduated cum laude with a degree in political science from USC and earned his JD from USC School of Law. As an undergraduate student, Tommy was a Bill and Melinda Gates Millennium Scholar and served as student body president. He is the recipient of the prestigious Algernon Sidney Sullivan Award, the highest honor awarded to a USC student. Tommy was selected by the state newspaper as one of the 20 under 40 leaders in the community and received Columbia Chamber's Young Professional of the Year Award. He is the founder of Cocky's Reading Express, which has provided over 120,000 books to children in South Carolina. In 2014, the White House asked Tommy to assist with the launch of President Obama's My Brother's Keeper initiative to support the growth and success of young men of color. In addition to his work in education and youth issues, Tommy is a national leader related to preserving our nation's judicial system and protecting citizens' access to justice. Tommy remains active in his alma mater. He is the current president of USC's Alumni Association and is the youngest and first person of color in the university's history to serve in this position. He also represents alumni on the university's board of trustees. Tommy and his wife Felicia are very proud to be parents of their almost 2-year-old daughter, Charlotte, Fellow Rotarians, please join me in welcoming Mr. Tommy Preston Jr.
Good afternoon, everyone. Do we have any Gamecocks in the room today? Well, let me tell you this. Thank you, Beth, for that wonderful introduction, and I can't tell you how honored I am to be here. I feel like I'm back at home. I practiced law here at Carolina. Was here, as you know, as an undergrad and law student. So lived here for about 12 years, and then got stolen away by a client, and now working for the Boeing Company. But my heart is always in Columbia, and thank God I have an opportunity to stay connected to this community through my work at USC, through the Alumni Association and Board of Trustees. I will tell you this, though. One thing that's not in my bio that I think is important to mention, we're all excited about over the weekend, but I got to tell you, this guy was even more excited. Because I happen to be from Clemson, South Carolina. That's literally where I grew up, in Clemson, South Carolina. And made a good choice, Rusty, right? And I got to tell you, the last few months, it's been very hard to go home and visit my parents and grandparents. So I'm looking forward to next week driving up to the upstate and wearing my garnet and black and celebrating a national championship. Or maybe two, right? How about that? Well, let me tell you this. Let me start by again saying how honored I am to be part of this this program today. I am very familiar with the work that this Rotary is doing in this community, and the work that you all do on a daily basis is truly having an impact not only on this region of the state, but the entire state of South Carolina. There are a number of friends in the room today, and when I think about what you do professionally and personally, the impact that you have extends way beyond the walls of this room, but certainly the corners of this community. I have to thank Dr. Kay Shaw with the Department of Commerce. So the reason I'm here today is Boeing became the first company in South Carolina to commit ourselves to doing outreach in all 50 counties in South Carolina. Because we recognize that in order for us to continue to grow and prosper in the years to come, we need to make sure that people in South Carolina see the work that we do. And more important than that, we have an obligation to help build a new generation of future Boeing employees Boeing employees and future employees not only aerospace, but also in advanced manufacturing. The University of South Carolina Moore School of Business did a study just last year that indicated that because of companies like Boeing, the aerospace industry generates $19 billion of economic impact on South Carolina each year. And our company has about 100,000 direct or indirect jobs because of Boeing being here in the state. So when we talk about Boeing South Carolina, one interesting thing that you guys should know is if you went to any other Boeing facility around the country, you'll notice that our name is Boeing in whatever city that that facility is located in. So you have Boeing Mesa or Boeing Chicago or Boeing San Antonio or Seattle. Boeing South Carolina was named very intentional because we believe that Boeing's success in this state can't hinge just on the people in the Lowcountry, that it's going to take the entire state working together to make Boeing and our suppliers and other partners successful. So we're spending the next 2 days in Richland County, visiting schools in Richland 1 and 2, talking to students about advanced manufacturing and aerospace, and really encouraging them to think about careers in those areas. And while they are in school, to really focus on doing well in math and science and some of those STEM areas, because we know that in order for them to prosper at a place like Boeing, you got to do very well in math, math and science. So we're spreading the gospel this week, and Kay has really been instrumental in helping us organize this trip, and we're very excited to spend some time at Columbia College tomorrow. Our new general manager at Boeing South Carolina, Joan Robinson Berry, is one of the highest ranking females in the company. And she's going to have an opportunity to spend some time with the students over
at Columbia College tomorrow. So today what I thought I would do is tell you a little bit about what's going on at Boeing. I understand that we've had some Boeing folks come visit in the past, so I don't want to share something that you've already heard. But I want to show you what we're doing right now, but also to talk a little more about Boeing's impact on this community and some of the work that we're doing in the Midlands. So I'll talk for a few minutes and be glad to answer any questions or talk about any topics that you may be interested in. Does that sound good? Perfect. So I have a little slide here. I'm going to go very quickly through this because I want to talk more than just show things. And if you're on this side of the room, you probably can't see it because this screen's not working, so I'll talk it out for you. Last year, 2016, we were honored to celebrate our 100th anniversary. There is another company in South Carolina that was celebrating their 100th anniversary, too. Can anyone tell me who that was?
Rotary Club in Columbia.
Is that right?
Yes, sir.
There you go. All right. Good. Good. 1916. There was a manufacturer also celebrating their 100th anniversary in upstate.
BMW.
Yeah. So you had two major companies in South Carolina celebrating centennials last year. And I got to tell you, for Boeing, one of the exciting things about our company is that we're an American homegrown company, started in the Seattle, Puget Sound area, and for the largest part of time, that's where we build airplanes. We had a huge defense apparatus in St. Louis and Texas and some other places, but in terms of building commercial airplanes, the Puget Sound area of Washington State, that was where it was at. That's where we built all of those twin engine planes that you fly on and see operating around the world. But in 2008, 2009, the Boeing company did the unthinkable. They decided they wanted to build airplanes beyond Seattle and chose South Carolina. And I got to tell you, it was interesting reading some of the articles that were written about South Carolina in some of those newspapers over on the West Coast, where one that always stands out to me is that they compared South Carolina workers to be equivalent to Walmart greeters, literally in an article in a newspaper. So they questioned whether or not we had the capability, the skill set, the education system, et cetera, to be successful at building some of the most complex machinery in the world. And I got to tell you, being a South Carolinian, being down in our Charleston facility, we are building airplanes quicker and better than other places around the world. And I think that's a testament not only to the workers that we have in South Carolina, but it's also a testament to the fact that we had this entire state and the community just embrace Boeing and make sure that we had everything that we needed to be successful long term. So while we have been celebrating our 100th anniversary, I like to say that we're thinking about the next 100 years and those next 100 years being here in South Carolina. So we're a global leader. We have a presence of about 150 companies. One thing that's always surprising to most people is 70% of the planes that we build in our facilities across the country are actually going to customers around the world. So if you were in our facility in Charleston right now, you would see American and United, who are two of our largest American customers, but you would also see Air Canada and Air Japan and so many other international customers who have relied on Boeing products for a number of years. Our total revenue is about $100 billion. That's an amazing feat for an American-born company in this day and age. We have about 20,000 suppliers around the world, 300 of them being here in South Carolina. So 300 companies in South Carolina are benefiting from Boeing's presence here in the state. You guys will be interested to know that 11 of them are in Richland County. So 11 suppliers and vendors that we're working with in this community, generating just this past year over $1 million worth of work from the Boeing company. We have about 160,000 employees in 65 countries around the world. A little less than 8,000 of them are here in South Carolina. In just a moment, I'm going to show you the work that we're doing that goes so far beyond just building airplanes. So, speaking of airplanes, how many of you have been to the Boeing facility before? A few of you have. So Boeing, here in South Carolina, we're building the 787 airplane. And these are three pictures of those planes right there. We believe that this is one of the most innovative, fuel-efficient, exciting planes on the market right now. Folks who fly on this plane, and usually if you're buying a 787 airplane, you're likely to be using that that plane to fly from the United States to another country, because it allows you, because of the fuel efficient nature of the plane, you can fly from the U.S. to New Zealand or places in Asia without ever having to stop and refuel. So customers, airline customers and passengers are able to get to places much quicker than ever before. But these three planes here, we started with the 8 and 9. You may have seen recently where we finished completing the first Dash 10. That's the larger version of that airplane, about 330 seats on that plane. And the reason you may have noticed that plane being delivered is because out of all of the companies or manufacturers that President Trump could have chosen to go to, he chose to come to South Carolina and visit Boeing South Carolina to see the rollout of that airplane. So the first 787-10 rolled out just a few weeks ago with the President of the United States speaking to the Boeing employee. And we all say that no matter what your politics are, that was probably one of the most exciting days for Boeing South Carolina and certainly for the future of our for our company. These planes have the potential to be game changers in the aerospace industry, and the fact that we're building them in South Carolina makes it even more exciting. One neat thing about the plane, we have a sister site in Everett, Washington, so we're building half of each plane in those two locations, but the Dash 10, the new airplane, will only be built or manufactured or assembled in South Carolina. So every plane that you see, there's a piece of it coming out of South Carolina, but that plane, the Dash 10, will only be assembled in this state. So something that that our folks are very proud of. So very quickly, one thing that makes this plane different, we're not using aluminum or titanium materials like most of the planes on the market right now. 50% of our planes are made out of carbon fiber composite material. You see a number of automotive companies are using carbon fiber material as well. We had a customer come in recently that talked about the savings on time by having a plane made out of this material. So you know right before you get on a plane, as they're starting to move your luggage onto the plane and you have the vendors that are bringing in the soft drinks and snacks onto the plane, a lot of the customers talk about how often one of those machines between the two, the luggage machine or the vendor or snack machine, will run into the side of a plane, it'll put a dent in it. They have to take it off operation for a bit to try to fix those mistakes. And just the amount of time and money that's wasted on that. With a plane like this, you don't have those problems because of the material that our product is made out of. So customers are already talking about the cost savings and the time that's saved because of the materials we're using that other manufacturers aren't using. One neat thing to show you is our plane is, there are pieces of it all coming from all over the world. This chart right here is showing you suppliers from all over the world that are making a piece of this airplane. So we're using the ports, we're using our Dreamlifter airplane, which is essentially a 747 that we chopped off the roof, we raised the roof, and we're able to fly to multiple locations around the world and put our supplies on. So our suppliers, and we have suppliers across the state that are using the rail system and trucks to transport materials to our facility. So there's Every bit of transportation that you can think of is using, is being used to produce the planes that you see here in South Carolina. So I'm going to stop on this slide for a little while and talk to you about South Carolina, why we came to South Carolina. And I'm preaching to the choir when I talk about this, because you guys see this every single day of your lives, in your workplace, in your homes, your churches, your communities. There's something unique about South Carolina, and the Boeing Company knew that pretty early on. It was the state, local, the community coming together, making sure that Boeing had the resources we needed to be successful. Everyone always talks about incentives and things like that. A company doesn't decide to come to a location simply because of incentives or whether or not they're in a union or non-union environment. There are a number of factors that decide whether or not a company comes to a particular state. And South Carolina had the right combination of everything. From the state government, community government, working hand in hand with us, which you don't see around the country. I was just telling John earlier today, when we have a weekly call with our partners around the country, and they talk about frustrations that they're having with government. It's either too much regulation or just personality issues. And we laugh here in South Carolina because we don't see that. We have a governor who's a member of this club. We have a former governor and a legislature that's committed to our success, and we see that every single day that we're operating here in South Carolina. And being a homegrown South Carolinian myself, I see that every day, how committed South Carolina is to this company. The education system, you know, I'm a product of public schools from kindergarten all the way to law school. And I got to tell you, we're doing something right here in South Carolina. And I'll tell you this, companies like Boeing wouldn't be in South Carolina if they didn't think the state of South Carolina had what it took to make sure that kids were educated and had the knowledge that they need to be successful in the workforce. Do we have challenges? Absolutely. But we are committed to working alongside South Carolina to make sure kids grow up, graduate from schools here, and have an opportunity. Whether it's with Boeing or someone else. One program that I'm always really excited about at Boeing is we have a program called Learning Together. And an aircraft mechanic, for example, can be down on the floor. He went through 2 years of Trident Tech, has an associate's degree, came into the company as an aircraft mechanic. He's working alongside engineers because being in a non-union environment, our engineers, aircraft mechanics, IT specialists, all of these groups of people are working together. They're not siloed in a way that we see in some of our unionized facilities around the country. So this aircraft mechanic decides that he or she wants to be an engineer. So Boeing literally will pay for that aircraft mechanic to go to an engineering school in South Carolina and not pay a dime of that education. So we have employees at Boeing in South Carolina that only came into the company with an associate's degree, and now they have their PhDs, every single dime paid for by the Boeing company. So we're excited with programs like Palmetto College at USC and others that allow our employees to essentially take classes online so they can work by day, take care of their families, take classes on their own time. So we're starting to see programs like that really have a tremendous impact on our employees' ability to get high-quality education in a time that fits their work schedule. And whether it's students at USC or Columbia College or Benedict or somewhere else, Boeing is literally paying every dime of that education for their employees. You'll be interested to know that out of the nearly 8,000 employees here in South Carolina, 10 of them actually live in Richland County. They're driving to Columbia, driving from Columbia to Charleston every single day. So when I say Boeing South Carolina encompasses the entire state of South Carolina, I genuinely mean that. We're in all parts of this state. We talked about some of the political reasons coming here. The workforce issues here. Working with the state of South Carolina, Ready SC, almost immediately coming in, the state of South Carolina said, we will help you train your employees. We will make sure that they have the skills that they need to come in immediately and do well at Boeing. And these individuals aren't doing traditional work that you think of in a manufacturing facility. They're using 3D printing and robotics, animation in some regards. So we're a very high-tech company that our employees are getting that training in the technical school system here in South Carolina. So this state, when I say has embraced Boeing, has gone above and beyond anything that we ever could have imagined. So we believe it's our obligation to give back to this community. So over the last few years, we've contributed nearly $30 million to organizations across South Carolina. A few of them I wanted to mention here today in Richland County. So University of South Carolina, which I'm very proud of, you may have heard a few years ago, started the McNair, Ron McNair Aerospace Research Center. We're doing a major composite research right here in Columbia, South Carolina, and Boeing committed to doing a multi-million dollar research agreement with the university to do that research work. City Year Columbia, some of you may be familiar of, which literally places students in classrooms across across this community to encourage kids to go into STEM areas once they graduate from high school. City Year is a major partner of ours. Early on in our history, one of the first investments we made in South Carolina was to Adventure Children's Museum, because we recognized that that we have to start earlier in terms of engaging young people. We can't wait until they're in middle and high school to get them ready for the types of careers that we have at Boeing. We have to do that much earlier, and Adventure is certainly doing that. And the Columbia Urban League, some of you may be familiar with JT McLaughlin. JT has become one of the leading advisors for the Boeing Company, helping us through challenges that we face not only here in South Carolina, but across the country as well. And we have a great program with him to get students in Richland and Lexington counties, and Fairfield as well, involved in STEM careers. So as I mentioned, over $1 million just this past year in South Carolina, in the Midlands of South Carolina, something that we should be really proud of. And I made a mistake. I mentioned $1 million in terms of our vendors and suppliers. That number is actually $3 million of our suppliers in Richland County, and $1 million for our nonprofit work that we're doing in this community. So Boeing is here to stay. We expect to be here 50, 100 years and beyond. And we know that the longer we stay, the more successful we become, the better it is for not only our company, but for the state of South Carolina. I'm going to go to one more slide to show you some of the additional work we're doing. We're building airplanes here in South Carolina, but in addition to that, we have an IT center of excellence here in South Carolina, one of just a handful in the entire world. We have hundreds of IT specialists here in South Carolina. You can come to Boeing not only working on building airplanes, you can be in the IT space as well, and they're doing some amazing work there for the entire enterprise. Our engineer and design center, where we're literally designing airplanes not only to be built here in South Carolina, but beyond. That facility is here in South Carolina. Our propulsion South Carolina facility that's working on the inlets of one of the engines of one of our other airplanes, is in Latson, South Carolina. So we're not only focused on the 787 program, but other programs as well. And one final area that I'm always excited about is Boeing Research and Technology. I call these the location where our 007 projects are taking place. This is where we're working on the future, whether it's defense or commercial or NASA aerospace related. Tremendous work going on in that facility across South Carolina. So a lot of great things happening here, and I think I have one of the best jobs in the entire world, because I get to work for a company that has its footprint in so many places around the country and around the world, and I get to see every single day the impact that that company is having on the state that I love so much. So with that said, I would love to take any questions that you have, talk to you about issues that you might be interested in. Yes, sir.
I know when you guys started out, you wanted to produce a plane every 10 days. What are you doing now, about every 2 or 3 days?
So we do about 12 to 14 planes a month. And that's pretty good for a state that didn't build airplanes before 2009, right? Yes, sir.
Should I add that you also donated to the South Carolina State Museum, I'm a volunteer there, the observatory, which will see the eclipse of the sun this summer, is there, and it's the Boeing Observatory.
Absolutely, and I would get fired if I didn't mention the Boeing Observatory. If you go to the State Museum, literally the observatory in that facility is was brought to the state by Boeing, and we literally have kids visiting that facility every single day, learning about space and stars and aerospace because of that partnership with the State Museum. Appreciate you mentioning that. In addition to that, we have a program in our facility where we bring fifth graders to 12th graders to the facility every single day on field trips to learn about aerospace and advanced manufacturing. And to date, we've had over 250,000 kids either come through that program or we've gone to their schools, because we recognize that they're schools across South Carolina where kids can't easily come to us, so we go to them.
One more question.
Yeah. Okay, Rusty had his hand up.
Recently, I became aware that the tours of the plant had been discontinued for some reason, apparently temporarily, but I just wondered if you had any idea when they would start up again.
Yeah, so as many of you know, we were right in the middle of a union campaign that was a very interesting experience, to say the least. And we did discontinue tours during that process. We're back giving tours again. There are some rules for tours. Our focus is obviously on kids, so they're always going to have first priority. We also have community groups come in as well. So there are parameters in which we don't do private tours. We don't do individual tours, but if you're with a large group, there are parameters in which we would allow folks to participate in that. What I would say is we would love to have a delegation of Richland County folks come down and spend some time at the facility. So I'm extending that invitation today, and we'll coordinate through Kay Shaw to invite leaders from this community down to see Boeing in action. Around up here at front and answer any additional questions and get to know you guys even better. But again, it's truly an honor to be here today. Columbia is home for me, and to be able to come back here and share about what we're doing at Boeing has been very special to me. So thank y'all so much.
It's really neat to have one of the world's most high-tech companies in our state, and they're tickled to death to be here, and they're benefiting from the work that employees in our state generate for them every day. That's just a really neat thing. Thank you, Tommy, for being here.
Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, one quick mention on the golf tournament. We'd love to have you play. If you don't want to play, think about sponsoring and providing some friends or customers or whatever an opportunity to come play in our tournament. We need your help, so we hope that you'll play, but if you can't, think about sending someone else who can in your stead. So with that, we'll close with song.